everyone, my name is Kajal and welcome to my channel. Today I'm talking to Tej and we're talking about supply chain management. If you're new here, consider subscribing and hitting the bell notification so you're notified every time I come up with a new video. So let's get into it. Tell us a little bit about you.
So my name is Tej Ruparel, everyone, and I'm originally from Mumbai, India. I moved to the US around 10 years ago now to pursue my master's in industrial engineering. And I started my journey in the US in Los Angeles. I went to the University of Southern California there and have since lived in the San Francisco Bay Area for the most part, but was in Atlanta for a couple of years as well to pursue my MBA.
You moved on from your master's into the Bay Area and started your first job.
Absolutely. So after I graduated USC, I landed a gig with a kind of a niche consulting firm here in the Bay Area. And essentially what we did was transportation management consulting, or more generally speaking, supply chain consulting. So think about moving products from the port of LA to the different stores, or think about moving goods that are produced in China to all over the world, right? So what is the most efficient, fast way to move that product around? That's what the software enables you to do. And implementing that software for our clients in a way that works for their businesses was essentially our roles.
Nice. And then you mentioned the keyword supply chain. Can you elaborate a little bit more on, you know, what is supply chain?
Sure. So think about a product that you use every day. Think about a toothpaste, right? So you get up, first thing you use the toothpaste. Any process that was involved in you producing the toothpaste and getting it to the end consumer would fall under this supply chain realm. So think about sourcing the raw materials that go in the toothpaste, the plastic for the tube, the actual paste, the packaging, all of that, sourcing of that raw materials, moving it to the factory where it is produced and assembled, and then moving it from the factory to actually the end consumers or to markets where it's going to be bought. Everything in that, all of those processes essentially are under the supply chain management umbrella.
Nice. So now that, you know, you said that you take parts of those processes and you want to optimize it for your client.
Correct. So essentially what we were working was only in the transportation management processes, right? So think about moving that final tube of toothpaste from the factory in China to, say, the market in the US. So you will go from a port in China to a port in, say, Los Angeles, and then you take that product and then distribute it across the US to all these different stores, right? So all of those processes, how do you optimize it? How do you make sure that the product is getting on the consumer, on the shelf at the store at the right time without being exorbitantly expensive, was everything that I did as a transportation management consultant.
Nice. And then how did you work with your clients? So was it, you know, they hired you and you did everything and then gave them the final product, or was it, you know, working together with them all the time?
Well, consulting is a very collaborative, you know, work environment. So for the most part, we were actually at our client's site, wherever they may be, right? So I've had the opportunity to travel all over the US, Canada, Mexico. I spent a lot of time in Mexico City, which was super exciting. So usually the engagement model is where you will go to the client site and work with the project team from the client and kind of sit down with them. And it's a very, very collaborative effort, right? Like, because we as consultants would not necessarily know the ins and outs of that business. So it's a part of learning that and making sure that we are adding value and helping them improve their business processes. So very highly collaborative. I mean, obviously every project has its nuance and engagement models are a little different, but high level, that's true for most consulting engagements.
So then does it mean you are on the road a lot?
A lot, right. It's very typical for consultants to be on the road at least four days a week. So I think most large consulting companies will have you travel Monday to Thursday. Because we were a smaller company, we would travel Sunday to Friday or sometimes longer than a week. But yeah, you do spend a lot of time on the road and that's expected. That's the consulting life.
Okay. And then how about interactions with the client? Were it a lot of meetings? And, you know, what would your tips be on, you know, how to deal with people? Because you're working with another set of people, but not from your company.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, yeah, there's definitely a lot of meetings, essentially, you know, especially in the early parts of the project when you're still trying to get to know the people, trying to get to know the business, right? So definitely quite high on the meeting fronts there. My personal experience with meetings has been that while they feel like a waste of time, if they're well conducted, then they can be super useful in getting work done. And, you know, to your other part about having effective meetings, a couple of thumb rules that I always follow, right? First, know why you're having the meeting and ask if you really need to have a meeting or if it's that a question that you need to, you can answer over an email, right? I think a lot of people who are invited to the meeting will invest their time to come and talk to you. So you want to make sure that you're respecting their time and your own time, right? Just having 30 minutes on the calendar to talk about nothing makes no sense, right? So I think that's a key part about having effective meetings. Make sure you know what you're trying to get out of it. And it always helps sending out the agenda beforehand so that the participants of the meeting know what you're talking about and what you're trying to get out of it. So I think that those were a couple of things that I always try to use on, you know, when I'm scheduling meetings or trying to have conversations with people.
Yeah, no, that is great advice that if you can get this answer over an email, you don't need to get together and have a meeting.
Exactly, exactly. So yeah, be very cognizant of people's time and just respect it. I think that helps.
Yeah. So now after this consulting gig, you went back to school. You chose to go for an MBA.
That's exactly right. So while I was in, you know, still a consultant, I kind of realized that, especially in the supply chain realm, nothing works in a silo, right? So even though we were only talking about transportation processes, there was a big impact on an upstream process like sourcing the goods or a downstream process like warehousing and storing the goods, right? So what I realized is that I wanted to learn how to understand the breadth of a business process and the various impacts it can have, which is why I decided to go back to school and pursue a full-time MBA.
Nice. And you went to Georgia Tech?
That's right. I went to Georgia Tech, the Scheller College of Business.
Nice. What was the experience of doing MBA like? Because you're coming from an engineering background and this is management.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Oh, that was quite a switch. I mean, first thing first, after being in the workforce for almost 4 years, it was quite difficult to get back to the books. But you know, after getting used to that, I think it was a fantastic experience. From, like you said, you know, coming from an engineering background, the biggest switch was working in a more collaborative setting, right? Because for most part in most MBA programs, you have a lot of group projects or teamwork and collaborative efforts that you have to put together. And that kind of takes some getting used to because you're constantly working with new people. You're trying to solve assignments that you've never come across before. And I think that's the biggest part of an MBA program, you know, learning to work in these different group settings, which for me was a little bit challenging in the beginning, but I think at the end of the day, that was the most fun part, you know, dealing with so many group of people and learning everybody's working styles.
Nice. Any advices on that front?
I think the biggest one I would give is keep an open mind. You know, everybody has a different style of working and they may not always match yours, but you just have to be open to their style of working. And also you got to remember that everybody has a different perspective, right? Everybody has a slightly different way of thinking than you, and you just have to be receptive to that because that's kind of what group work is all about. That's what our teamwork is all about. Everybody bringing is in this diverse set of views to find the best solution. So yeah, that would be mine.
Nice. And how was it going back to workforce after your MBA?
It was smoother than I had anticipated it to be. It was great to have a salary coming in every 2 weeks, I won't lie. But I think the transition for me was quite smooth. I think for me personally, it was easy because I found a job that I really want for a company that I really liked and in a place that I really wanted to live in.
And what was the difference between consulting and now your new role? What changed in terms of your duties and how did you approach that?
Sure. So obviously, it's a very different world where when you're a consultant, right, you're on a project for a very short period of time. I mean, it could be a few months, maybe a couple of years at most. But when you're in the business and you're at a part of a company, you're living that process day in and day out, right? So I think it gives you a very different perspective. You're just not trying to quickly find a solution to a problem, but you're also thinking about the longer term impacts of how you're going to, you know, work every day and engage with people. So it's definitely, and it also has a sense of ownership quite a bit, right? Like now it's not about completing this project and handing it over to your client. You are essentially the client and you have to live with whatever decision you make every day. So it's definitely a different perspective, I would say. And I kind of like it.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right. My last question to you, as a person in career and who's had so much of time in the industry, what are some of the important skills a person should possess to have a successful career?
I think the one thing that I try to live by is be a person that people would like to work with, right? I think there isn't usually enough emphasis on soft skills and being able to work collaboratively in a setting. I think it's a lot of emphasis is on technical skills and not enough people talk about soft skills. So my advice would be, you know, while you can always learn technical skills, I think soft skills are harder to learn. So how do you work in a team setting? How do you make a presentation? And so I think people should start also investing in their soft skills as much as in their technical or more hardcore skills, I would say.
Yeah, you know, number one, communicating with people.
Exactly.
How to do a presentation.
The minor things matter, right? So yeah, that would be my advice.
All right. Well, thank you for doing this interview.
Thank you for having me. This was great.
And thank you for watching this interview. I hope you found this useful and you can consider supply chain as an industry that you would want to go in. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like and don't forget to subscribe. See you next time.